you know, you think, well, okay, you know, the purpose would be to set the table. I'm going to set the table. And so I, or go shopping, whatever the thing is. And you can tell, okay, you come in, okay, the table is set. And you can say, okay, well, the results are that the table was set. And therefore, the purpose that I was serving was a higher, you know, higher service of higher principle. But then you have to look at the whole results. And like when he says you have to accept what is as it is, you have to be able to accept it all on all these levels at the same time. So if all the people, like you got the kids out and made them take all the, you know, the stuff out, and you were, you know, you went in there, interrupted the cooks, and like made, you know, interrupt, you know, whatever, had a conflict with the cook about how the table should be set up, or what, you know, all those kinds of things, those are part of the results. It isn't just that the table got set. It's the table got set and there's dead bodies all over, or the table got set and people, the mood of the meal was really influenced by the conversation that was going on, whatever, gossiping, or whatever. So it really is a lot of levels to the results. So you can't just look at one level of the results. You have to look at the whole level of the results. But the results do indicate the purpose that was served. I was just now thinking of some of the things that happened in the last celebration. For example, like the John T. Piece that we did. If you look at the results in terms of just how well did we do the piece, we did really bad.
Oh, I heard a story about John T. America.
What did you hear?
I heard they did John T. It's funny because I didn't tell them exactly how we did it. A little bit. But they did John T. with just the main characters. And then the audience was expected to fill in for the rest. But what happened is that most of the people who have experience in John T. were not in the audience. They were busy doing other things. So most of the people there didn't really know the play and the music and the whole thing. And so I heard it was the worst performance they ever did, but I don't know. It seemed to me that some alchemy happened here, so I don't know. But it was kind of a flop.
Huh. And how was it here?
Well, here, the results I would, from the feedback that I heard from people and what I got, was that it was really outstanding. Really amazing. It really impacted people.
the piece was
theatrically, the results was terrible. You know, it was like ridiculous. It was totally, you know, people were trying to speak. People didn't were trying to read and speak American words that they didn't even know. You know, so there was no. But people were. But the result was, on, if you include every level of the result, it was a really. Something happened in that play that made a difference for the whole space and everybody involved, and everything really here in Europe, I think, was affected by that.
Mm-hmm. I heard from a lot of people that they really enjoyed it and had some effect on it. Mm-hmm.
So you have to include all of the levels when you're looking at the results.
Can there be when the result is not serving the higher purpose? That there are hidden purposes in between.
Yes. Yeah.
It's contaminated.
Yeah, it's contaminated. Because those hidden purposes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So somebody committed to set the table, which would be, and to make a sacred space, a sanctuary, mm-hmm. where we can come and be fed and nurtured and have communion and invoke the divine. By the way you're setting the table, and yet, even though the table got set, you know, there's revenge and jealousy and territoriality and competition and that kind of thing was going on. So those are all hidden purposes.
To this person.
Yeah. And they don't even really know
because
it's hidden to them.
Yeah.
But everybody else feels the results of it.
Mm.
And you go, you know, and that's the impact. You can see them, you said, really fast?
Yeah.
Enchanting? Oh, in the chamber.
You can see the room, you can see the nether space.
Cleaning.
The children.
John,
yeah.
What did you say?
Using the children to get on needs met. Neurotic needs met.
Yeah, so that everything which comes to us from outside is a mirror of our inside. It's kind of the law.
Yeah.
So, do you think that pure self-observation, just doing that, can reveal a person's hidden purpose to them, or that they need a more impactful process to find that?
Theoretically, just self-observation.
That would be my guess. Otherwise, I think Lee would be giving us a stronger thing to find those pieces. Well, he's giving us support groups.
Yeah, the thing is, if you discover it through self-observation, then you created the realization of it. And so you probably won't destroy that realization. Mm-hmm. But if you go into a support group and somebody else creates the realization of it for you through feedback, it's really easy to destroy that realization. You know,
but
you walk
yet, he's still giving us that tool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think you just must have had, kind of from the beginning, just self-observe, because you are so in your patterns of your past, so you are just seeing everything through your
glasses,
and you are not able to self-observe at the beginning, and so we send people to therapy and keep support groups just to strengthen this ability to self-observe. It's kind of steps towards it. And I think it is valuable that others, that you get this feedback from outside, and maybe after a while you don't need it anymore. But he always thinks it's good to listen to feedback.
And he's always telling me to keep getting feedback.
Yeah, that's a continuous process. Pretty long.
I was just thinking how you said that Lee had us do therapy or whatever process, or and it's almost like those are classes, like side classes in relational yoga.
Yeah.
Those are extra credit.
Yeah.
Fill in the classes for how to, to improve our yoga technique, our yoga relationship techniques, our method, our procedure, our form. Practicing the form.
It's not.
Yeah.
Self-observation is something that you have. It's something that you really have to practice. To give it and to keep it alive. That's ego is so strong, and we are in our physical, in our bodies, and there are so much influences which just disturb the self-observation. You just have to train.
In the Gurdjieff school, they used a lot of attention exercises, different forms of splitting attention. Bennett, J.G. Bennett, wrote even a book about those exercises. It was amazing to see some of the things that they would be doing. But just to practice paying attention and splitting attention, because you can't split your attention consciously without effort. We split our attention all the time unconsciously, because we chew our gum, gossip, drive the car, pick our nose, and cuss at the other driver all at the same time, and listen to the radio.
Well, we split our attention in more conscious and stronger ways too, but we can, for example, not everybody, but people have different skills, but somebody can genuinely be with a child and cook a meal at the same time. Other people can't.
Mm-hmm.
But least some of it's just natural tendencies and types, but the thing that's really difficult is to be observing the ego dynamics. You know, that kind of attention splitting is really, it's really hard.
Yeah, there's a, I was thinking about how there's like, in one way, there's like two basic types of ego strategy. One strategy is that says, I'm not afraid of anything. And the other strategy is that I'm afraid of everything. And both of them are defense strategies. Because the truth is that you're afraid, and sometimes you're afraid, and sometimes you're not. And it goes, you know, you have all kinds of feelings, but the strategy is, it's a general like cloud. Like, I'm always afraid of like everything, and the other one's like, you know, I'm not afraid of anything. And those two, when they get together, you know, they drive each other crazy. Alice in Wonderland? How? Like, what are you thinking of?
Like when wherever in which space she is, when she wants to find something else, she either misses a right level or a right dick. But she has this will to use.
All right. And so that's what we need, is some of that stuff. Because most of us don't have that stuff.
But you said neither one is.
No, it's, that is, I mean, somebody caught me once that way and he had me figure it out. And so, I mean, to me it's right here, it was my friend, you know. And it's both just the same, like the little one, the generosity thing. Nowhere is really vulnerability.
Neither one of those is vulnerable, is what you're saying.
No.
Yeah.
And serving, and it's not none of it. Both is.
Being little or being big.
It's
being afraid or being.
Right, it's all ego, it's all grasping, it's all survival, it's all. Like it was the heiress in the one, and she's running after that white rabbit. You know, it's been a lean.
White rabbit, isn't that a song?
That's one of, what's her name? Mom, isn't it?
White
no,
rabbit.
Maybe it's Mama Cass or
something. One of the poems is sung to white rabbit.
Oh, yeah?
Just put that music.
Glasgow is
a song. Was it a song in America? I don't know.
It was a song in the late 60s or early 70s.
Mm-hmm.
A rock song.
Oh, yeah.
It's about Alice?
Alice in Wonderland, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So another question about the purpose thing, because I've noticed that the hidden purpose and the higher purpose is what's important is that a person come to the specifics of that, like the language and that it is really precise.
That's what we said in the talk that I read. No, the last talk I did here, we were reading the notes from that. Those talks up, and he was saying you have to know that map. You have to know the details. You have to look at it in the face, every part of it, or you're trapped by it. You can't go on.
So I found that, again, like I did that process, so I have some of the words for it, but just kind of in a feedback process this week for me, somebody named it with a couple words. And it's not that they're unusual words or words that I haven't heard before, common words, but they exactly fit the experience of the situation. And that, to me, having that kind of precision about it and not doing the, like accepting what it is as it is really incredibly valuable. And that, as from the inside, the self, the ego self, will not label it with precision. It will not, because once it's labeled with precision, it's too
threatening, so the ego is not wired up to self-destruct. It's wired up to survive, so that, like, that's something I got about feedback this week, was that another person can help me get to that precise language and that precise map. And it seems like it's not like drawing it on the board of, okay, there's the, here are some words, and picking one. It's like the words are they're custom tailored to the situation, like the manifestation.
Yeah, it's funny because ego is ego. It has to be ego that gets us into a situation where that kind of precision will happen, and yet ego can't do it or won't do it. Like, it has to be a beyond ego process that produces the clarity of the self-observation to remember it, because we can see it for a moment and then shift identity and not remember what we saw and just forget about it for 3 months or 6 months or something until we see it again.
The guru seems to kind of support our ego in the beginning, especially so that we get kind of grounded in, we get kind of addicted in a way to that attention, that you get padded in, and then at the bottom falls out of it or something. And I think that's true in all schools.
My question about that, I mean, what I thought was, there seems to be some kind of initial healing that happens at some level. It's like just sort of a general self-acceptance or being accepted.
It's like the great mother or something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Embracing us.
It's like we're healed at a whole level. Lee says, you know, I think he said something like, you know, as soon as you become a student of a master, it's handled. Like everything is handled. It's all in the master's hands. And the rest is just the wash or whatever. It's just like whatever. But it's all handled immediately, so it's like the healing is there, and the rest is, well, how do you spend your time profitably evolving in the presence of the master? Like, that's the hammering and the heating and the hammering and the heating and cooling and hammering and heating, like that.
Yeah, this book that I just read is really present for me, because this guy, when it got to the feedback stage and the demand for more commitment and stuff, he started moving away. And, you know, it was, up until then, I guess I'd describe it more as the honeymoon stage. And then the teacher started, like, you know, turning the screw. And it was lawful, too. I mean, he knew it. He knew it later that it was lawful and what his errors were.
I was reading the other day a piece about Maya Baba, how he's working with his students of the Holy Spirit. And it was about jealousy. That is really short piece, it's so well described, like how he in the beginning, like, gets all this intention, and then he knows and sees you right from the beginning, what, you know, where are your weaknesses or whatever,
And then if there's only a little thing that he sees anywhere, or dormant in where jealousy is, that at one point he will start working with that. But he's really, then he will put his attention away, and then he will step there and look around and see something's missing and what's going on. And then he will come to you and say, is something happening? And play the innocent back. What's going on with you? And then he would poke in that person and ask him and find out what it is for that person until it all comes into light. And then they get this as a task to work with this. They get challenges keep coming until they're through with it. But in the beginning, he makes it all big.
When we were first coming into school, I remember there was about a year worth of time when Lee was really talking about how it was up to us to make ourselves a big target for the teacher, too. So that it was up to us to arrange it so the teacher was managing our business. And what percentage of our business was the teacher managing, you know, of our life, you know, and how our ego or psychology, whatever, we would manage the teacher's management of our business. So we would try to maneuver things around and manipulate things so that we could control and manage how much of our life the guru managed. And his invitation, like he said, like the real invitation is to have the guru manage your life 200%, which is
200.
Yeah, more than just 100%. What did you say? In the next life too, right? Or else you, waking life and your sleeping life. But it's really fascinating to observe how we undermine and forget and jockey for position and set up other circumstances in our lives so that we are managing the guru's management of our life. So they can only the guru is in a corral. You know, like, you know what a corral is? It's like where you keep the wild horses. So you put the wild horses in a small part of your life and keep them contained in there so they don't just like run over your whole life.
So we try to keep him in the corral?
Yeah, he's the wild horse.
Well, I kind of noticed from being in the office so much and watching people kind of come with their personal preferences that he just goes, well, that's fine. You know, that he doesn't try to rope us in until we're willing to be roped in.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's learned that from experience, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's energy management. Yeah.
It's like we're the ones who are managing our own. Let's see. We're the ones who have to bring ourselves into that state of realization, and then we have created it. And then if we've created it, we won't destroy it. A person doesn't usually destroy that which they create themselves. So if we can create the realization ourselves, then we won't destroy it.
Well, a couple of summers ago too, he started on this thing about the secret lies.
Mm-hmm.
That he was gonna start tearing apart people's secret lies. And I know for myself, I thought I knew what my secret life was, but I didn't. So when he informed me of my secret life, I was surprised that that's what it was. People think they know what a secret life is. I'll say what your secret life is. I don't think so. I mean, not based on just what I said, but would you kind of guess?
My secret life is self-destruction. That's what I see. Unconscious strategies to not make healthy things. is that for one even?
I don't know what it is, but I know what it has to do with, I'm sure, getting attention. I'm pretty sure.
That's not a secret. But you
I said what it's,
yeah,
for what I'm using it. I don't know what it is, but what I'm using it for is probably for, to get attention.
The secret life.
Yeah. Or what keeps it alive is...
Mm.
I think last one leads to secret life. I thought that what that meant was something that was secret from him. But that's not what it meant.
The secret from ourselves.
Secret from ourselves,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was kind of the thing.
What an illusion if we think we could hide something.
For him, yeah.
For him.
Yes, that was already a big illusion.
So
the tradition that we are in, the Western Bao tradition, is an relatively new, I suppose, tradition, but it's also not a very popular tradition, probably because of the kinds of things that we've been talking about in terms of what the kinds of practice that that we're invited to do, I mean the practices of the tradition. So if it's a relationship yoga, that compared to simply doing sitting or doing a physical posture, it's a very confrontive kind of yoga that is very fast and very subtle and very easy to fail in more than once. And it doesn't just end when they ring the bell or when the sesshin is over. It's an ongoing yoga that happens even in our secret lives. I mean, happens everywhere, kind of all the time. There's not much chance of us having a free day, you know, like to go home from the workshop or like to have a doctor's excuse or, oh, my back hurts, so I can't, you know, I don't have to practice today. It's like, oh, I'm feeling, you know, superior, so I don't have to practice today. I'm feeling revengeful today, so I don't have to print.
Can I tell some out of it from Rabbi's book?
Yeah.
So in this book, this guy, he was a founder of one of the Zen centers in America, and he brought a Roshi there, and he would have his vacation time every summer and go to the countryside and up to the mountains. And as time went on, the Roshi started like suggesting to him that he like sell his little cabin or that he spend more time at the Zen center. And then he started getting sarcastic when he'd go, oh, you're going on your vacation. And the guy knew what he was pointing at, and the teacher was encouraging the man to stay. He lived nearby. He lived a couple blocks from the Zen Center. He didn't actually live at the center. To stay there and to be, not going away on this vacation thing. And there were other things that he wouldn't do. A lot of the Zen ritual stuff, he just wouldn't do it. And like it just got to the point over the years that he started fading away from school because of his resistance to take the next steps, you know, to give up his private little vacation time, to give up his rigidity around what he was going to do, to give up his rigidity or his attitudes toward the other students. And one question. They have they have sessions where they have a private speaking time with their teacher. I can't remember the Japanese name for it, but it's a formal time with your teacher. And so he asks him what could he get from the Zen Center? What could he get from coming around there? And the Roshi said, that's not what it's about. It's about what can you give to the Zen Center? Because he was thinking, well, if I'm going to come around, then if I'm going to be giving up my own private life more, then, you know, what is it that I'm going to get in exchange for that? Teacher continuously, and then he left for quite a while. He
continuously what?
Bargaining with him. And he was in decision-making position in that school also. The Roshi wanted to create this really authentic and big Japanese temple in Minnesota, and the whole like board of directors like voted against the teacher, and still. When the teacher died, there was a lot of sadness that his vision hadn't been fulfilled by that school. And this guy came back. He came back a couple of years before his teacher died, and then he started seeing all those years that he had wasted in his resistances to kind of going the whole nine yards, as we say in English. That really brought up to me what is that in my own personal practice in life with Lee. What are those things that I'm holding back?
Are there any, from our reading, anybody's different readings, have you read any more of Lee talking about the yoga of relationship as being, I've only heard that phrase, that's the only thing that I've heard. Somebody said, what's our yoga? And he said, it's the yoga of relationship, and that's the only thing I ever heard. Has anybody read anything anywhere else about that?
He talked about that in
summer
here. Is that when you heard it was here? Because he talked about it here.
I don't know.
Well, when he says, he makes several times, maybe there's someone that come on that is about war all the time. So this is for me, when you, on this when you start to discover that the war is going on in our relationships around us and in ourselves, that's it. We wouldn't have to do it. It's all about relationship actions. And everything is the mirror, it's our own ultimate self. Everything which is coming to us is all, and which is created around us is the mirror of our internal relationship.
Well, if the form of the yoga is only described by kindness, generosity, and compassion, if that's the form, and and there really isn't any other tool to work with that except self-observation and then feedback from support groups, for example. And it's not very easy to attain the form. It really takes work to consider about the form and to attain that form.
You said we're in work school.
It's not like it's given, you know, in these yoga books, if you look at some of these yoga books, they have these photographs of these. Of the form. And I wonder where the diagrams or photographs of the form are for us to model ourselves on. It's like you were saying, it's where are the models?
Well, we have the book Conscious Parenting, that's talking about relationship with children.
There are all these books on love and sex, I believe, love and sex.
All these books.
But if you read those books, it's a high form. It's a really high form of practice that he's talking about. He's talking about, like you said, being neither attracted nor repelled, being that which nothing can take root in, being a manifestation of kindness and generosity and compassion with a wisdom that is not inherent in our own selves. It doesn't come from our parents, it doesn't come from our history, it comes from something way bigger than us. And like that's the form, it's the only form, it's like total and absolute responsibility for what we produce in our environment. He's talking about consciousness.
Well, it's also making distinctions because we can play out low drama. Is that the term, low drama?
Yeah.
We can play out low drama under the meaning of kindness, generosity, and compassion. And to ego strategy, I mean, sometimes it takes a while to see that that's not really what's happening. So, I mean, Lee's talking about his grumpiness, and people might think that that's not very kind, but I'll tell you, sometimes it's like the balm for the deepest wounds is, you know, to have him yelling and screaming. It's like there's a healing that happens. And I'm not saying that we should model after that. And that's not what he's asking us to do, is to model after that particularly. But I think that when we speak of kindness, generosity, and compassion, there's also, you know, there's ruthless compassion. And there's generosity that's much more expansive than just giving somebody something.
Yes, it can also be a straight feedback that can be generous instead of holding it back.
Mm-hmm.
So I think those terms are really big and broad, and that we have to be very careful with them, and that we know inside ourselves
set environmental feedback to us, but sometimes it's not instantaneous. I just, you know, in doing some 12-step work too and watching people try to kind of pull apart some of their family things that were set in place, it's so easy to confuse, like, in codependent relationships, what kindness is.
Mm-hmm.
It's really easy to confuse when we're being kind to each other or, you know, kind to another, when really we're just like we are codependently supporting their dynamic, or we are not doing something different because of our own fears. So, and at the same time, some really simple principles also. But I think there's an element of distinction that we have to kind of hone as we go along in this work.
And how do you hone it?
By sitting and watching and trying again and not giving up and radical reliance on the guru and obedience.
So those are two more forms. Radical reliance and obedience, and not taking it personally at the form of relational yoga. It's not taking it personally.
Yeah.
And radical reliance on the guru is another form that doesn't just have to do with the guru. It has to do with, if he's minding your business, then those people who are in your lives are part of this business, are part of that form that he's given. So if you're radically rely on the guru, then you have to go, okay, this is part of the formula, this is how it, this is the guru in my life. Gratitude. Part of compassion is gratitude, and there's different parts of compassion that we can work with. So, you know, you can pick out a part like gratitude, and instead of going compassion, which is sort of this unbelievable, who knows what really that is, you can pick out a thing like respect, or compassion, or acceptance, or trust, or whatever, something, and parts of it. Sometimes when you're doing yoga positions, you'll get into this a position, and then you'll this heat will build up inside, and you'll start sweating, or your muscles might start shaking from, you know, being in that position. And normally, you would normally that would be so uncomfortable that you would stop it immediately to get out of that position. But because it's a yoga, you go into it and you stay there way longer than is comfortable. And you're sweating or shaking or cramping up, you know, and yet you still don't get off the posture. And so if the posture is kindness or generosity or acceptance and compassion, then it's like being kind until you're sweating and shaking. It's like being kind way beyond uncomfortable.
Like observing and sweating and shaking at the same time.
Those words don't
seemed to imply that we would have to be sweating and shaking in order to do them.
No, time. It's easy.
It seems like it's a conflict in terms. I'm not saying that it is, but it seems like it would be within those are in the nicing realm.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, in the Yoga tradition, the aim is not to run off the aim, but the practice is not, and the proposition is not to force yourself in ideal positions, because that you would destroy yourself, or you would hurt yourself. But just to go as far as you can go, and just to stay in high.
In a different way than I'm grown up with, which is facing something unknown to me, which is not familiar to me. And there you are again with radical reliance on the guru and faith. And that actually, you described that pretty much in the beginning. That for me is the image of relationship that is really alive in the present moment. And I find that very difficult thing to do.
So what you were saying, full point, like the aim is not to force yourself into the position, but the aim is the process of becoming able to be in that position. How would you say it?
Yeah, to put yourself into the process and to be with it, and to go as far as you can go, or to do the practice as far as you can. To do it. And actually, what is it that makes us making a step? It's not us. It's just the grace of the Guru, the grace. It's a non-linear process, totally. And part of our illusion is that we think we can make it, and we are thinking linearly. And at the same time, when we are thinking linearly, and we imagine how it should, how actually the process should go and should work, but it doesn't. Does not at all. We can't predict. No, we can't predict. We can't predict. It's every situation is. Although we are repeating patterns and things and habits, every situation is somehow new, and it's a new challenge. To our practice.
And I'm certainly adding about yoga relationship and hospitality, seeing with a lot of hospitality. Most of what I heard, I was listening to kids do it, most of what I've heard about hospitality is receiving guests. But the law of hospitality also
which I really observed when I was in India with Lee and watched him being a guest, that it also involves how we are guests. And even though it appears that we are all hosting people here, you know, during seminars and celebrations, the reality is that we're all guests. We're always guests here, all of us. And that there are certain laws that of hospitality that pertain to being a guest also, not just expecting our host to live by the law of hospitality, but for us coming in to live by the law of hospitality as a guest. So that was something I was thinking. And the other is something that maybe Andrew Collins said to our community when he was visiting our shop a couple of years ago in Arizona. I think this came from an outside source, that what he saw was over-familiarity in our school. So, to
like
me...
Arnaud's example, that our school is over-familiar with...
No, I
didn't say it, but we addressed that how it is in Arnaud's school. They said they are supposed to say you as a friend.
Yeah. But this came also from somebody else.
Oh,
also.
Andrew Cole.
I think it was Andrew Cole. And I think about how that over familiarity is often one of the things that is destroying hospitality of both in both directions in our community. And does everybody know what over familiarity is?
Mm-hmm. But do you mean what does he mean? What was that? Familiarity with a guest or the person you visit or you are, so as a guest or as a person who receives guests, or with within the household, within the people who live on the ashram.
Well, I would say that over familiarity can pass between anybody. I'm not just speaking about people who live here and people don't live here. It's kind of...
He used casual.
Casualness, an attitude, like thinking that our life here is about being friends, like developing friendships and knowing what's going on in each other's minds. And, you know, Wilf said this one thing that I really liked was that, you know, what is going on in my mind is nobody's business, and what's going on in another person's mind is not my business. And I see how much we try to mind each other's businesses and have projections and have opinions and, you know, what's going on there. And we and over-familiarity is also like trying to smooch up with somebody, trying to get in tight with somebody. And then as soon as that tightness starts coming, now we think we have certain rights, we think we can say certain things. This is really easy to observe and go over the boundaries of Lee's household, because it's pretty clearly defined. But as soon as there's like a lack of practice from our end and their end, there's a way that we can become over-familiar and then step over boundaries. And then the next thing, there's some kind of, I use that word contamination again, we contaminate our relationships, our work relationships particularly, we contaminate them within the school. And I think that it's something that kind of creeps up on us, and then all of a sudden we realize that there's a great phrase, familiarity breeds contempt. So contempt is
hateful, respectful.
So, you know, as we keep kind of thinking that we have, that somebody's given us permission, or we've given ourselves permission to step into a certain person's life or business or position or, criticize them, or, you know, thinking we, you know, it's our right to read their mail or whatever it is. There's, you know, there's tons of examples. Then this kind of contemptuous relationship comes up lawfully and
mechanically.
No, I don't mean mechanically.
Law of the mechanics.
Yeah, the law of the mechanics.
Yeah.
The law of the mechanics. Familiarity breeds contempt. So we are responsible on both ends as guest and host. And, you know, to follow the laws of hospitality and within, you know, to also be hosting each other no matter where you live. Like it's my it's my personal responsibility to treat everyone like a guest. And it's also our personal responsibility to not step into each other's lives so much so that this contemptuousness comes up, because we should all know by now that that happens.
Yeah, I was actually going to say it the reverse, which is, it's like we each live in our own world, or we each live in our own house, and when I come to talk to another person, if I expect that they are in my house, that they have to function by my rules or my culture, my world,
mm-hmm.
that's not being a good guest. So if I'm going to go talk to somebody, I assume that I'm coming to be in their house, and then I'm going to function as a guest in their house, and in that way, then I can have a relationship with them. The opposite of like what you were saying is like coming in, and anyway, it's the same thing that you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Saying it a different way.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. But coming to somebody and go, okay, now I'm going to be a good guest because I'm going to be with them in their house or their world, and then you have a relationship. But you're practicing being a good guest and accepting things you wouldn't normally accept, or whatever you wouldn't accept in your house. Anyway, I need to go. Okay, so, Jai Guru.
Jai Guru.